with Dr. Ricardo Magnani, economist and Renaissance specialist. For the past 13 years, he has devoted himself to the study of Leonardo da Vinci and the Renaissance more generally. Thanks to his method of study and analysis, the Renaissance movement and consequently its representative by excellence, Leonardo da Vinci take on a totally new profile and often in contrast with what has been assumed for.
Thank you.
Hello and thank you. It's a pleasure for me to be here and to accept the invitation. Because when I started studying Leonardo, maybe 13 years ago, I found an entire room painted by a very young Leonardo, and I started to say that there was only two places that had much more contents of that room. And one of these was the ancient Bibliothèque of Alexandria. So it's a pleasure and an honor for me to be here. And I'm a particular scholar of Leonardo, and I'm trying to rewriting his history. So I'm not very good with diplomacy. I would like to thank the Italian Institute. I would like to thank the Biblioteca Alexandria. I'm very glad for the words that the president of the Bibliothèque this morning, because he said a big truth. Leonardo is a treasury of the humanity, not an Italian or French or Egyptian. And his roots are Oriental and Egyptian. So tonight we will see a different Leonardo, and we will see which is the deepest link with the Egyptian culture. So, Leonardo is a false myth, okay? It's the sum of several clichés, the result of endless presumption, which have been determined by wrong interpretation of document sources. It's very hard to say this after many scholars or after several words spent during this year celebrating Leonardo, but that's what I'm getting with my studies. So, as Leonardo left written in one of his quotes, nothing can be loved or hated without a full knowledge of it. This is a basic teachment, a normal teachment to approach reality, but nobody follows it normally. And the consequence of this approach that Leonardo suggests us is that studying Leonardo in depth is possible to realize that the character, as we know him, has been affixed a mask. According to this mask, Leonardo is described like a self-taught, an ingenious, standoffish, lazy, homosexual, vegan, inventor, painter, engineer. He was not so many things. According to this mask, we assume that he was born on 15 of April, 1452. He was the son of Piero Notari Vinci and a slave named Caterina. He died the 2nd of May, 1519. This is why this year is the 5 centuries celebrating. And he moved to Milan in 1482 and died principally as an expert in military art by Ludovico il Moro. This is not true. As Goethe said, the most difficult thing is to be able to see what is in front of us. We are not used to see what is in front of us. We are used to see what we are expecting to see, not what is in front of us. So that means that the mask is often in our eyes, not on Leonardo's character. So what I will do today, in a very simple manner, is to remove this mask and show you who Leonardo was and what he left us. Really. We listened a lot of things before about Leonardo, but I would like to try to explain the root of Leonardo, starting from the beginning. So, the beginning is Leonardo's date of birth and parenthood. Because what I say to you is completely supported by documents. The same documents used by scholars to describe the Leonardo that everyone knows. Vasari, De Pagave, and Argenville are considered the most authoritative biographer of Leonardo. Also, all of them agree that when Leonardo died, he were more than 75 years old. More than 75. So, Leonardo's date of birth is placed by Vasari in 1443, by De Pagave in 1444, and by D'Argenville in 1445. Regarding the biographer of Leonardo, I want to remind you that the only one who spoke about Leonardo and his age with a full knowledge of facts, because he lived in the same time, was Antonio de Beatis. Antonio de Beatis was the secretary of a cardinal, Luigi d'Aragona, then the 10th of October, 1517, goes to Amboise meeting Leonardo. And in his notebook, he wrote, "We went to visit the Florentine Lord Leonardo da Vinci, an old man over 70 years old, an excellent painter of our times." Again, more than 70. It's math. 1519 less 70 or more is 1440 and little. So, according to these documents, therefore, Leonardo's date of birth is clearly stated between 1443 and 1446 by documents. I imagine that the question now you've been asking yourself is, how did it happen that Leonardo's date of birth has been fixed the 15th of April, 1452? You have to know that writing the biography of the greatest Renaissance painter, sculptor, and architect, including, of course, Leonardo, scholars refer to what Giorgio Vasari wrote in a book, titled Le Vite, published in 1568 with the license of Pope Pius V. In this book, in the pages concerning Leonardo, Vasari wrote, "Really wonderful and heavenly was Leonardo, son of Piero da Vinci." This is the main cause why Leonardo is placed 1452. Why? Because as a consequence of these words by Vasari, written with the license and the privilege of Pius V, it's been only in 1746, three centuries later, that the biographer called Giovanni Battista Dei finds in the state archives of Florence a note written by the father of Ser Piero da Vinci, declaring the birth of his nephew Leonardo, the 5th of April, 1452, at 3 o'clock in the night. But there is no relationship with this Leonardo and Leonardo da Vinci. But to clearly understand what I'm going to tell you now, it is useful to understand who really Pius V was. He was the third Dominican Pope of the history. He was the general inquisitor of Lombardy, where Leonardo grew up and spent more than 15 years of his life. He was the founder of the Index Librorum Prohibitorum. And he named Cosimo I de Medici as Grand Duke of Tuscany. So, there is a version of Le Vite, published with the license and privilege of Pius V and Cosimo de' Medici, that said that Piero da Vinci is the father of Leonardo. According to this brief biography of Pius V, it justified the doubt that Vasari's version is not reliable. Also, it has radically determined the biographies of Leonardo, as we studied it today. In fact, no one, or very few people, knows that there is another version of Le Vite, published in 1550, 18 years before the one with the license of Pius that said completely different history. In this first version, Vasari wrote something a little bit different. So wonderful and evenly was Leonardo, grandson of Ser Piero da Vinci, who was a very good uncle and relative, helping him in early age. So, Leonardo is described as the grandson and Piero da Vinci, uncle and relative. There is a little bit difference between son and grandson and between father and uncle, as everyone knows. To make matters worse, Vasari adds the following words. Also, he was not the legitimate son of Ser Piero da Vinci, again. He was, on the part of his mother, born of good blood, not a slave. Good blood. He's not the son, and the mother is not a slave, but good blood. In the 14 pages concerning the life of Leonardo, Vasari wrote 5 different times that Ser Piero Notari in Vinci is the uncle of Leonardo. So, the start is completely different. And if you start from here to going to Cairo, but you take the direction to Cape Town, you arrive in another place. This is what happened to Leonardo's life and biography. So, the assumption that Leonardo was born the 5th of April, 1452, and that he was the legitimate son of a notary in Vinci and a slave is a mere presumption. Like the most part of life and operas of Leonardo, they are the results of mere presumption. With documents. Leonardo in Milan. In the same way, we analyzed documents. We know for sure that Leonardo was in Milan the 55th of April 1483, because he signed the contract for the Virgin of the Rocks. This is the only autographer by Leonardo, the only one existent. Leonardo's first present in Milan, according scholars, goes officially back to the spring 1482. As a consequence of this letter, you see, he would have written to induce the Duke Ludovico il Moro to hire him at the court of Milan as a military expert. But this letter is not written by Leonardo. It's very simple to analyze the calligraphy of Leonardo, and this is not written by Leonardo. So, again, we analyze documents. Once again, there is an endless number of documents that denies this assumption. Benedetto Dei, that was an ambassador of the Sforzas, and Anonimo Gardiano, that is the name of a manuscript in Florence, both they describe a different thing. Benedetto Dei, that bring Leonardo very young to Milan and say that Leonardo was in Milan before 1480. And Anonimo Gardiano described two different times that Leonardo were in Milan. So again, documents declare something different. But it's not only this. Once again, it's Vasari, the first version of Le Vite di Vasari, to give us the most important information on Leonardo's presence and attitude in Milan, confirming what is stated in the documents of Benedetto Dei and the Anonimo Gardiano. In the documents, Vasari described Leonardo coming in Milan very young, with great reputation as a musician and a painter, visiting the Duke Francesco Sforza. And the second episode tells about a paint sold by the notary in Vinci to the Duke Francesco Sforza. This means two things: that Leonardo were a great musician of lira, this is important, of lira, and he was a skillful painter. But when this? When the Duke Francesco Sforza was alive, and Francesco Sforza died the 8th of March, 1466. So it means that Leonardo arrived in Milan before this date. Again, with documents, the life and biography of Leonardo is completely different. By documents. So, we have confirmed about this directly by Leonardo. Leonardo painted the Annunciation in 1472, portraying himself in the angel. That is the same portrait that Verrocchio made with the David, as told before, but it's the same of David of Donatello. There is so many portraits of Leonardo that you can't imagine. There are more portraits of Leonardo than stars in the sky, because he was a master, a reference for everyone, and everyone makes a portrait of him since he was born. The same landscape painted by Leonardo in the Annunciation, that is a landscape that I know very well because it's on the Lake of Como and was Lecco, my town. The same landscape, copying Leonardo, will be taken up by almost the greatest Renaissance painters. Here is by Domenico Ghirlandaio, with a very young Leonardo that peeps out. So Leonardo is placed by painting in the north of Italy, Milan, much more before than scholars. Leonardo that portrays himself in the Vitruvian Man. And portrays himself in the Mona Lisa. Because the Mona Lisa is not a lady, a real one. It's not Lisa Gherardini, it's not Pacifica Brandani, it's not the mother, it's not Bianca Maria Sforza. The Mona Lisa is a philosophical concept, is the portrait of Leonardo in the feminine. It tells about the duality of which the whole universe is composed. Two opposing energies, one symbolically called masculine and the other feminine. This is a philosophical concept, and it's very clear in the expression of Tao. The wedding of yin and yang, masculine and feminine, sun and moon, black and white, up and down, the opposites. But why Leonardo hide this concept in his works? Because as the director of the library told before, Leonardo studied with books coming from Orient, from Egypt, from Greece. And all these men always know that the secret lies in bringing together these two opposite energies, one ascending and the other descending, which are balanced since the origin of our entire universe. But at the time of Leonardo, this could not be said because of the Pope, because of the Inquisitions, the complaints, the accusation of heresy. So you cannot say it, but you could repaint it, or play it, or drown, or done all these things together, as Leonardo made, and as I will show you in a little. For this reason, art cannot be read without considering the deeper meaning that artists like Leonardo Botticelli, Raphael include in their works to escape the papacy censorship. Art is not only color, it's not only form. There is a substance that painters communicated us. And it's very, very clear. Approaching the art in this way, we will realize how Renaissance has its roots in the art of the main culture that preceded. We saw it before, talking about Earth, painted by Leonardo. Especially the art of Leonardo, who was the absolute master and reference for all the artists of his period, era, but also modern, if you think about Dalí. Dalí copy Leonardo, copy Raphael. So, the bird of Zeus represents the same spiritual condition expressed by the hair of John the Baptist. Leonardo didn't invent nothing. He copied. He copied by the classical. So, when Leonardo drew the course of the river, he wasn't talking about the water. But it is the expression of the migration of souls called metempsychosis, the infinite life, that it is not material but is spiritual, of the souls. So, when Leonardo wrote, "The water of the river you touch is the last of the one that went and the first of the one that comes," so the present time is not speaking about the water of the river. He's speaking about our energy, our life that never died, as the ancient Egyptian, as the Oriental, and so on. This phrase by Leonardo is not only in his mind. He refers to some concept of eternal life expressed by the motto Pantarei, attributed to Heraclitus. One cannot descend twice into the same river, and one cannot touch a mortal substance twice in the same state, but due to the impetuosity and speed of change, it's dispersed and collected, comes and goes. The same concept. Leonardo is copying Heraclitus. This is the reason why several painters of his time painted, portrayed Leonardo as Heraclitus, opposite to Democritus. Again, the contrast of the opposites, material and etheric. That is the concept expressed by the Mona Lisa. So, thanks to Heraclitus, at this point, we finally found the correspondence between what is expressed by Leonardo in his opera and the ancient Egyptian culture. Nobody tells you what I'm showing to you now, but it's the real root of Leonardo's concept, and it's the real root of the Renaissance art concept. Without knowing this, you cannot understand the art of that period. So, this is why I decide to speak about this and not talking about singular operas. or the life of Leonardo except of his birth and coming in Milan. So Heraclitus said, what is opposition is a court, and from the discordant things beautiful harmony springs. All things are born by the law of contention. This is Heraclitus. When a black hole exploded, generated two opposite forces. These are the two forces Heraclitus is speaking of, that generates a rotation. These two forces generate our universe. This is the root of our presence, and this is the root of what Leonardo and all the culture talking about. The same concept is expressed by the Tao, as I showed you before. But the same concept is expressed in music by the name of Bach. Bach is not a real person, it's a school. And Bach is a meeting of the two movements, one ascending and one descending, B and A, C and H. And this name explains the same concept of Heraclitus. What is opposition is a chord, and from the discordant things, beautiful harmony springs. This harmony is called music of the spheres. And those things are born by the law of contention. This is the cause generating life for and everything is in the universe. But Leonardo knew very well this concept, as he wrote in the historics. When B goes down, A grows. The counterweight that is born in great silence ends in great power. This is the synthesis of the contrapuntistic music that explains what happened in the universe. This is not music, this is physics, this is maths, this is astronomy. Not casually, Leonardo, like King David, Orpheus, and then Apollo, were all presented as excellent lyre players. Referring to the harmony mundi, the sound of the universe, in fact, Cicero, the Greek philosopher, wrote, and the man who knows how to imitate on the lyre the concert of the heavens and rediscovered the path to lead to this sublime kingdom. This is the main meaning of art. This is the main meaning of our existence. And the philosopher and the painters transfer us with their operas, but we have a lot of things that takes us away from the right route. Religions, cultures, convenience, opportunism, speculations. So we arrive to what I decide to transfer to you, the link between Leonardo and Egyptian culture. There is an opera by Verrocchio and Leonardo, mainly by Leonardo, that extreme what I told you, much more than each other. If this one, conserved at the National Gallery of London, Raffaele and Tombiolo. Leonardo is portraying himself on the left. And please, if you pay attention to details, you will find the connection between your ancient culture. The ankh, the spikenard, the necktie, wings, anubi, the ankh again, the cylinder that are in the ends of all the statues of pharaohs that are used to balance the corporal energy, and the Oxyrhynchus, that is the fish that ate the spinas of Osiride. Nobody will tell you about this opera in this way. But the most important contents of this work is what has been in front of us for centuries and nobody was able to read it before. As Goethe say, what is the much difficult thing with your eyes to see what is in front of you. The ends of Raffaele and Tombiolo represents different accords, opposite accords. And the opposite accords makes together an harmony. This paint reminds words by Heraclitus. What is opposition is a chord, and from the discordant things, beautiful harmony springs. And all things are born by the law of contention. That is, the law generated by the explosion of the black hole. This is physical. That is what the double helix of Leonardo reminds of. The stairs of Chambord. That reminds Archimedes' screw. We saw it before. Not in case to get in water again and again and again, endlessly. That reminds DNA helix. That's the law of contention. Everything. This helix, in an orthogonal projection, becomes a spiral. That reminds to the supreme law again, which forms and rules everything. The spiral of Fibonacci. I've been in Béjaïa, in Algeria, in April, talking about things to the Fibonacci's academy. As Leonardo didn't invent nothing, Fibonacci didn't invent nothing. This is the deepest knowledge of man. We know it since the night of the times. And we pass time by time to sun, this knowledge belongs to everyone. Leonardo belongs to everyone. This supreme rule is mentioned in the Myth of Earth by Plato, as given up by the spindle of Ananke. And referring to necessity, Leonardo wrote in one of his quotes, "Necessity is the teacher and the guardian of the nature. Necessity is the theme and inventor of nature and the rule of eternal life." Without a set get Leonardo, you will never get the Renaissance art. You will never stop wars between cultures and religions, men versus other men. As Baudelaire wrote, "We'll take you for a madman who, without hearing any music, see you dancing." Today.